I'm glad to be here. I'm glad that Javier just took all the questions, so hopefully I won't have much. Many thanks, Julia, for the invitation. I am very glad to be here. And the work I am going to explain today is a work that was undertaken by several people, maybe as much as maybe 20, 25 people. It took us about maybe five or six years. We are trying to integrate a model for trying to take from our research into the production systems and to know where are the weaknesses, what are the opportunities to do research, and what we have got. The content of the talk is we're going to talk a little bit about the problem that Javier already mentioned about this, about all this climatic change, the productivity lost. I'm going to talk a little bit about this intensive system, the description and contribution, which already has been explained by Javier, and what our results that we have got so far, what are our challenges in terms of adoption, in terms of the more research needed. Okay, I think a part of this has already been talked by Javier. Latin America's agriculture is characterized by high levels of rural poverty, for food security, migration, environmental degradation aggravated by climatic change, and energy and ecological crisis. This is something that Altieri and his collaborators have said some time ago. What we got in Mexico, we have a loss of productivity mainly associated by overgrazing, uncontrolled burning, which is one of the biggest problems we still have in the country. We don't have alternative ways of reducing it. People try to get rid of all the organic matter to make the agriculture much easily. And this also has led us into the efficient soil fertility management. So our current status is deforestation, desertification and climatic change, unprotected soil increase, erosion and evaporation, heavy and erratic rainfall distribution. This is particularly a very serious problem in Mexico because although probably the amount of rain still remains the same or more or less the same, is the way in this rainfall is being distributed. We have maybe 1 or 2 days all the rain for a month, and then we have a very long dry period. Incremental temperature, well, maybe here it wouldn't be too bad, but in our conditions, we are now above 40 degrees, especially in April and May, and this makes very, very difficult and a lot of changes, increasing number of days, hot days. And this has been caused, especially as you already are aware of, emissions of CO2, increment of air temperature associated with the emissions of CO2 by different reasons, emissions of CH4, methane, nitrous oxide, NO2. Well, most of these are, of course, coming from in our terms of production. CO2 comes from these feedlots, which is very common in Mexico in particular areas in the north. Increment of rainfall precipitation, of course, also effects of climatic change related to the distribution of species, changes on the behavior of the trees, incremental distribution of plagues. Every time we have a new insect plague, a new disease, and this is something that we have to be facing every day. So in this project, we are thinking of how to face this problem. 9% of emissions of CO2, 35 to 40 emissions of methane, and 65 of emission for the oxygen nitrous. And these are our challenge. Lack of animal feed throughout the year, deforestation, high production costs, long droughts, and extreme temperature. This is becoming very difficult every time. Livestock recuperation is an urgent necessity. I'm sorry, I didn't have enough time to translate this into English. But anyway, we have some national policies that are more focused into intensive systems rather than to look for a more sustainable system of production. And then this system of production that Javier already described, this is silvopastoral system, is one of the options that we are looking at, and we are trying to develop in more detail and trying to transfer to the farmers. Here, the situation in Mexico, as I said, every time is cold and desert. The evolution of the hot days, you can see in the last 2 or 3 years, we have very, very hot time, very dry areas. So we have an immediate change to transform the conventional agricultural systems into sustainable feed production systems. There is no more time. There are a lot of failures now because of the rainfall distribution is very erratic, because the high temperature sometimes, even the crops with enough water, that cannot flower sometimes. Silvopastoral system and ecological models that include biodiversity and require low inputs. We have here about silvopastoral systems in the past, which obviously it includes some legumes. But the big challenge that we face in this is how to make it a reality. We know about this association of grass and legumes, that all the good things that all the legumes bring, nitrogen fixation, improvement of diet. But then how to make it a reality to farm producers, and how to make an impact and real impact to the production of in the country and to the welfare of the social or the human beings. So as I said, silvopastoral system has been in Mexico for many, many years, but despite this, we have been working into our wrong system, destroying trees. So this system is proposed as a way to recover degraded areas. And we use a model. Javier already described a model in which Leucena is the, say, we say the horse, the main tree that around this go all the development of this system. Here, for instance, in this case, could be Leucena, could be another legume. And the advantage for us of Leucena is that it is native from Mexico. It is native from the southeast of Mexico. And about the question that I already mentioned here about if it cannot be a pest problem, there are different types of Leucena. For instance, there is a Leucena which produces lots and lots of seeds. We don't want that. The one that we are using now is a Leucena that produces a lot of foliage and certain amount of seed. So we are doing a kind of selection within our native varieties of Leucena. But because the other one, yes, of course, could be a very seeded type and produce a lot of stems, very little foliage, and maybe not so good for animal production. So the intensive silvopastoral system is an agroforestry model designed to improve agriculture, production, and quality in harmony with the environment. And all what we want to do is to emulate the native vegetation. The native vegetation that we have trees, shrubs, grasses, and all sorts of weeds, all sorts of different broad leaves, etc. So we are trying to emulate this through this model. And this model includes, of course, trees which could be, say, the main source of income in the long term for the farm. For instance, if we plant a wood tree like cedars, this could be very good to be harvested within about maybe 20-25 years, which is a very good income source. It's like the main capital, and the shrub ones will be like the medium time income. The main feature of this is the plant species diversity. We call it intensive silvopastoral system because it includes several species, many species, as many as we can. For instance, in the base part, where we have the grasses, it combines the tall type of grasses, the guinea grass, which is tall, combined with the stoloniferous one, it covers perfectly the soil. So we have a very good biomass, which produces a very good quality forage, but at the same time, it covers the soil. That's the important part of this system, that we're trying to keep the soil covered. And then we have the shrubs. In this case, we're using Leucena, because it's the plant that was well adapted to our condition in Mexico, where we have alkaline soils. But we can use any other shrub legume, which could be in different other regions where we have maybe more arid or more humid types. Also, we use improved grasses. Grasses that has been imported into Mexico from East Africa, but we know that they are well adapted, like star grass and guinea grass, and they are well adapted there. They produce very good amounts of forage, and this is the big mass. And also we use high livestock. Here I would like to mention that we, as we grow with this, and we understand a little bit more of this, we incorporate different system of rotation, for instance. There is a rotation that we are using now in this system in which we stay the animals in small paddocks for maybe 2 or 3 days, and then we move the animals, and then we let all the system to recover for about 30 days, 40 days. It depends very much on the season. How we do this? Okay. It depends very much on the conditions. It depends very much which type of tree we are planted. In our case, for instance, Javier and I have a farm on our own. We do some of our research there, and it's a good joy, but we have to invest a lot. But anyway, we learn a lot. And also, we plant the trees. Which trees? Well, it depends on the... We have to be careful about the farmer, because, for instance, in my case, I would like to be able to sell very nice type of wood. So I plant the trees without, well adapted to my condition. I plant them in those rows, maybe about 10 meters apart rows, and we planted the Leucena about 150 centimeters width rows, and then in the alleys we planted different type of grass in such a way that we cover and we produce a big biomass. Sorry, this is wood, some in 10 meters apart. So what we do, one of the key things is how to protect the trees in the early time. Because if you plant a grass, the grass will be about this tall within about 3 or 4 months, but the tree will be about this big. So we how to handle this. And what we do, we use electrical fences. We use several things to protect our main investment. Our main investment are not the animals, are the trees. So after a month of sowing the Leucena grass and the trees, 4 months, how long it takes? Usually it takes before the early grazing, a very light grazing, maybe about 6 months. Usually in the southeast of Yucatan, in the south of Mexico, Yucatan, where it is a bit dry sometimes, the shallow soils, it takes a bit longer, maybe 8 months, maybe a year. We usually wait for a year. Yeah. Okay. And this could be a limitation when you say to the farmer, okay, you are going to close down your paddocks for about a year and you don't have anything else. So we have to look for a strategy to incorporate these systems little by little until the whole farm is already covered by the silvopastoral systems. Then we put the fences at the watering points. So this grass, this is not grazing very well, but this is how it looks more or less after maybe a year. During the rainy season, we have the trees. Of course, those trees maybe are already 2 or 3 years old. It takes some time, but the grass and the legume are already there, improving the quality of the diet. improving the nitrogen already going into the system. We are also looking, something that I would like to mention to you is that we are also looking to the microbial that could help us to improve the nitrogen fixation. We are evaluating several strains. We are evaluating also the fungus to improve the phosphorus uptake of the plants. What we have found is that, for instance, we are improving the life of the soil. As already mentioned by Javier, that we have a program to establish. We already have the conceptual idea, and we wanted to move this into different ecoregions in Mexico. Then we move this into a national program, and to throughout the country. So these things, I don't know if I can show you, but anyway, the blue areas remain is one state. For instance, in this case, this is the state of Yucatan, one of the most beautiful in the southeast of Mexico. I don't know from there, but anyway. Well, if you know, this is Cancun, is somewhere over there. Well, this is 250 hectares already planted there, and 350 in the south, in Campeche, in Chiapas, Veracruz, 200. And this was done in the some time ago already. Unfortunately, as Javier mentioned, we have already about 10,000 hectares already planted of this system. This is the name of the states and the number of hectares already established under irrigation, under dryland conditions, and the number of producers that are already taking this idea. And this was adopted to some extent due to the support we have from the federal government. Because this system, we are aware that the system could be a little bit expensive because the land is so degraded that we have to actually start from the ground, from zero. Sometimes where we are where we have still some forest, that we use the trees that are in the forest, and we only introduce some legumes or some of the grasses to improve the cycle of nitrogen, to improve the biomass production and so on. But where we have very degraded areas, this could be very, very costly. Increment on forage yield and quality. These are more or less some of the figures, but I'm going to go a little bit further with this. Okay. Carbon sequestration, also we are looking a little bit of this. We have these amounts in a traditional system, 136 tons per hectare, and in the reconverted version of the silvopastoral systems, we have 180 tons per hectare. So we increase a little bit the amount of carbon that is being captured there. Forage quality, as I said, in this system that we are working on, which is based on Leucaena leucocephala, Panicum maximum, which is the guinea grass, and the panicum, and it's compared with a panicum maximum as a monocrop, or just a pasture. And then, as you see, there are some difference on the... here it is. I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with this apple. 9.9, the amount of protein, which maybe, if you see for a temperate grass, well, 9.9, that doesn't ring any bell. It's too low. But for our condition, in which the grass could be maybe 7 or maybe 6, this is quite good for a grass, 9.9, compared with the 7.4, which is the grass grown on its own. Whereas the Leucaena, of course, the Leucaena has a range between 20 to 30 percentage of crude protein, which is really very, very, very good. The amount of nitrogen, which is being fixed, about 84%, about 80% of the nitrogen which is in the system is fixed and transferred to the guinea grass. And here the amount which is being transferred, and this refers to the cycle
this is being cut every 35 days, and this is being cut every 50 days. So you see, as we let the grass grow a little bit longer, we have more grass. Of course, I understand the question that if we have a very long grass, maybe the bites are going to be small, and then the animals are going to spend a lot of time and a lot of bites, and maybe the animal intake is going to be reduced. But in this case, the tropical grasses need to be, if we take the grass, say, in the early part or early phase of the growth, we may not get the biomass, the ideal biomass that we want. Maybe we sacrifice a little bit the amount of grass which is being eaten in a bite, but we take more, we have more grass being produced. This is how it looks. It looks very nice. I really like this. It's, we have a combination, and the shrub, which is the legume, the leucaena, is available to the animals, and the animals actually they graze in an alternative way. They graze both species, and interestingly, we have seen that in average the animals tend to control the percentage of leucaena. I don't know how they do it. Maybe they have a kind of meter or something. But in average, we have found that they have about 30% of intake. There are some challenges still that we need to face. One of those is the content of mimosine. Mimosine is an alkaloid that could cause some problems with animals that are unprotected. What do you mean unprotected? The animals that don't have the bacteria to detoxify or to convert or to metabolize this mimosine into maybe a free volatile fatty acids or something like that, which make the animal to use that energy instead of being intoxicated. But what the animals do in normal conditions, they reduce the intake and they stop eating that plant, and then they eat the grass. That's the case when the animals don't have the proper bacteria within the rumen, and that's one of our challenges currently. We need to be sure that the animals that are the farmers are using have that bacteria within the rumen. So that's how it looks like. The conventional pasture demand inputs to the environmental cost, chemical fertilizer, herbicides, etc. Whereas the silvopastoral system is a high quality forage with environmental benefits. Here, forage availability at grazing, of course, is very high compared with only the grass. And you see, this is very, for us, 50,000 leucaena plants is really very, very intense. Maybe 20 years back, we usually have plantations or maybe 5,000 plants, because we have the wrong idea that the leucaena is competing with the grass. And after having done this experience, we already planted paddocks of 50,000 plants. Of course, in those days, we have to plant the little seedlings one by one. Can you imagine how long it will take to plant 50,000? So we started studying ways of how to improve it, how to make the planting easily using just the seed. Also, in this project, we have included, as already mentioned by Javier, that some animal experiments in which we found that about 800 and 1,000 grams per animal per day, which for our condition is a very, very good compared with the feedlots that we have in Mexico, in which they have maybe about 1,000 or maybe 1,200 grams, is quite good actually. Also, the increments of milk yield and reduction on cost, the cost of production, I don't know about the cost of production in here in England, but in the silvopastoral system, it's 1.23 in the traditional or conventional system. Why the conventional system is so expensive? Because they use a lot of concentrate. And one of the problems we are having in Mexico is where we don't produce much grain. A lot of the grain is being imported from the US.
You don't use any concentrate in the silvopastoral system?
We use in the pastoral system, we use some sources of energy. And it's something that we are currently being undertaking, trying to take advantage of the whole amount of protein that the animals are eating. Because if you see the protein that the leucaena has is above 20, and the protein that the grass has is around 9 to 10. So it's a large amount of nitrogen is already in the rumen. So we start thinking that the animals are using inefficiently all that nitrogen. So we are using different sources of energy, like maybe molasses from sugar cane, or also rice polish. This has two advantages. Firstly, which has some carbohydrates readily available in the rumen, and also has some fat. So it is a very good source of energy. So these two are the main that we are currently studying to tune a little bit and to improve the efficiency of utilization. Here we have the milk yield per cow. Well, you say, well, eight liters maybe it doesn't ring a bell. For our condition, when we usually have maybe 3 or 4 liters. 4 liters is quite good, it's excellent. And the live weight, as I said, is about 900 grams. The stocking rate, it went up. Maybe, in average, maybe around 4 will be something that could be achievable, because we increase the amount of biomass. What are the environmental services already has been mentioned by Javier, but something that I would like to say is that we improve the nitrogen availability. Improve the because of the nitrogen fixation, carbon sequestration. We improve also the recycling. Something that we would like to say too is that in these systems we keep the animals in the paddocks. We put the watering points in the paddocks, so in such a way that instead of bringing the animals to the corrals, the animals are within the paddocks, so all these feces and urine remain in the paddocks. Organic matter is also increased, natural fixation, as I said, and carbon sequestration. Another important part, because we could have a very bright ideas and very good systems, and very good and everything, but then the patient could die. We have a social impact. We need to find systems in which the people are interested. One of our biggest problems is that the rural areas are being abandoned. For instance, in the southeast, most of the young people are moving to Cancun or to the different areas to have more money, to have a much better standard of living, because there are much more jobs, whereas the rural areas are being abandoned. With this system, we try to keep the people there by increasing the opportunities, like the opportunity to produce seed of leucaena, the opportunity to produce a nice and very healthy cheese. One of the things that we found in this system is that the quality of the meat is especially good, particularly in the case of the type of fat. As Javier mentioned, this is being analyzed, but we strongly believe that we are going to have a better prices for these type of products, in which we produce the fat, we produce a nice fat, which is originated in silvopastoral systems, which could be very good for the human health. Also, the same case of the cheese. The cheese is a very nice source of omega 3 and 6. Okay, but we still have a lot of things to do. This is only the after 5 or 6 years is some achievements, where we found that we know less than we thought. For instance, of course, the adoption. That's one of the big challenges. How to make this to be adopted by farmers? And the main thing is the cost of establishment, especially in the very, very degraded areas in which you have to have a lot of inputs. For instance, a nice species. Of course, the input doesn't necessarily mean chemical inputs. Could mean plants, could mean microbials, could be different species of grasses. Also, we are facing very strong problems with the control of weeds. We are facing, as I am very much interested in the talk early in the morning, that this is also a strong problem in the establishment of the system. The identification of management of crops that offer multiple products and services. As I said, the system could be established and ready to be used within about a year. So we are wondering what the farmers could do in the meantime, how he can take advantage of his land, maybe to plant different crops, short period crops in which they can harvest and to have some kind of production. We are still evaluating this. Inclusion of crops during tree establishing of models in different ecoregions. Something that we found is that when we were researching, we go to the field and we make some talks to the farmers, but the farmers don't believe us, never believe us. Say, well, you know, this is good, why you don't plant this? And then we became a farmer, our own. And then sometimes they come to visit us and we have our farm like a model. And that's what we thought, that if we could establish models of production in different ecoregions, not necessarily of Leucena or this, but to have the same emulation of the native forest. Policy to stimulate the adoption, this is something that we need to convince our politicians that this is good, this is the way to go. Because sometimes they provide, for instance, support for chemical sprays and things like that, and without a direction. Some of the states in Mexico already took the idea and they are supporting more the sustainable production systems. As I said, we have still the problem of the mimosine. We are trying to face this. We don't talk much about this to farmers because they could scare them, because if you tell them that the leucaena could damage the cows, they won't let the cows eat it. But we know that there is a solution. But unfortunately, so far, we don't have it ready on hands to make an extension. But it's an area that has a solution and that we're sure that we are going to achieve it. Also, the leucaena, although it is a native plant from the Yucatan, it has a problem of insect. It's an insect called psyllid, Heteropsilia cubana. In its natural environment, this psyllid has its natural enemies. But in the nature, you found maybe about 1,000 trees per hectare, whereas we are planted now 50,000 plants per hectare. So obviously the natural control are over. So we need to look for ways in which the plant could be protected. So far we know that the Australians are doing some inbreeding, and we can maybe eventually incorporate these plants to improve the genetic and the resistance. To develop strategies to improve water use efficiency is something a new field that we are trying to develop. First, to know what is the water footprint or this system, and then to try to see if we can incorporate different strategies of management of the whole vegetation to improve the use of water. Well, we can conclude then that the silvopastoral system are productive options to improve the productivity of environmental services, but we still are learning about this. Also, it established different ecotypes within the tropical region to restore the degraded land. We are working mainly on degraded land. We are not, it will be a little bit strange if we say, okay, we have to destroy the forest and to establish this. That's not the way we are going. We are going into the forest, the degraded land already, and then to go up to this. Adoption of silvopastoral is a complex and slow process that requires a further research. This is an area that we are sort of, we were very, very happy that in the past, many farmers start trying to get this, but then after the flow of money was closed, they stopped adopting this. So maybe we didn't work properly. We need to find ways in which to make the people more sensible and to look for other ways of supporting what they are doing. For instance, today, if I plant a tree and I give an environmental service, nobody pay me back for that environmental service. But it has some cost, because if I plant a tree to cut to carbon sequestration, I may need to protect the trees and to make a lot of work, and maybe eventually after 25 years I will harvest these trees. Okay, but in the meantime I am giving some environmental service, which probably it will deserve some support. Thank you.
A little bit over, but if anyone could stay for a couple of questions, if anyone's got anything. Yes, Simon.
Yes?
Yeah, it's a question, sort of an ecological question. You mentioned a few times that you're trying to emulate the natural forest, the natural ecosystem of the area, in which case the cattle are fulfilling the role of herbivore in that system. So the question is, how closely do the cattle breeds that are being used reflect the grazing and browsing behaviour of the herbivore that would have been in the natural system? And is the absence of the bacteria in a stomach that helps to break down the alkaloids in the cana part of the same problem, because the natural indigenous herbivore may have?
Yeah, okay, thank you, very good. The natural animals that live there, I mean the ruminants, are the deer. Unfortunately, we almost killed them all. And I found some friends that took the rumen content of this deer after they died, of course. They took it and they put it into animals, trying to have that idea. And that's one of the problems that we have, that the native animals that graze, the shrubs, the cana, and all others, are well adapted. Whereas we introduce the silvotypes. The main breed is the silvotype, the white, I don't know if, but of course, we try to inbreed them with the European types to give more muscle, more meat. And we are going a bit far away from this. Okay, yeah, we are aware of that. And that's why we have to be careful how to cover with this. And that's why we sometimes in some farms, we found that animals are unprotected for one or another reason. They don't have the bacteria. The advantage of this is that the animals that are grazing the farms are close to the native ones, like the deer, these bacteria move easily, relatively easily. But if there are no deer at all in the area, the animals will be unprotected. So that's why we need to develop a way in which we can inoculate through the rumen with these bacteria. And we've been working on a project with the University of Queensland to develop a ways of transport these bacteria in a dry way, so this can be exported. We've been with our own resources, we have been trying to introduce different rumen liquids, and it's a little bit complicated to make it to transfer to one to another livestock. Health. But yes, this is one of the ways we need to look at, that we are aware that the animals that are grazing there, the natural ones, are the deer, and they have the bacteria for sure, because they live on the volcano. And the animals that are produced close by, they also have it, and that's one of the reasons we try to say, why is it that these cows are protected, and the cows about 100 meters, 100 kilometers away is not protected? But one way to go around this is to inoculate the animals with the proper bacteria, and that's one of the research work that we are undertaking. Yes?
Just a related question about the native species that you've used or not. And it's the grass species, so you've imported both of those species from Africa, so it was the Guinea grass and the star grass. In terms of the alternative models you might have considered, have you done any, had any thoughts about local species or more local species you might use for the...
I must say that in our local conditions, eventually, although we plant guinea grass or star grass, eventually we end up having maybe about 5 or 6 types of different grasses, including the native ones. We don't plant the native ones. We haven't, unfortunately, in that area, the native ones are more dispersed. They don't form as a pasture, as such, but they are very much dispersed. But you see them within a pasture, a cultivated pasture, they grow. They are very well resistant. They are one which is called the carpet grass, which actually this covered perfectly the soil, but we don't plant them, unfortunately, because we don't have we haven't developed the whole technology for harvesting the seed and all that, because the amount of biomass they produce is very low. They are well adapted to dry, but the problem is that under our dry conditions they flower in a very short period, maybe in about 2 or 3 months, they flower, produce seed, and die. And so you don't have more biomass in the rest of the year.
Well, I think we'd better close it there formally, but if you want to stay behind and ask more questions on a one-to-one basis, because I think some people need to go, it's 2:15. So if we close it there formally, but having shown a little video, and if you want to follow up with more questions, I think Lewis and Javier are here. Well, in fact, Lewis and Javier are here for a month. Peter's here for a week, and Anna's here for two weeks. So anyone who's in call or university can catch up with them. And thank you to everyone else for coming along too today. So thank you very much. And let's clap for the 4 speakers again.
Thank you. Thank you.